schedule, but Sandra, thanks for signing up for I think I saw you were on six, right?
Yeah, no problem. I had actually signed up for that one and then a much later one a few weeks ago, which is why I couldn't take this week, because I was like, I don't want to have to do two
chapters. Yeah, yeah.
So yeah,
makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, no problem.
I see Ron, you're going chapter 7, moving beyond linearity. That'll be interesting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Cool. And then I think Sham will still be able.
But that's cool.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the dates have changed a lot. So obviously, yeah, if there's conflict or something, we'll have to change it. But and I think Sham said he'd be able to do next week for the lab slash question. So
I didn't even get through this whole chapter in terms of reading it yet.
It's a lot. It is a lot. Yeah.
It was a lot. I finished reading, but I'm still very confused on some things. So it'll be good to talk them over.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I didn't stop because I ran out of time. I just stopped because I really wanted to digest what I got so far.
Yeah.
That's also a good strategy.
I would say overall, it's kind of like the level of math or like formulas and like explanations of those, the different components of these models that I was looking for with this mm-hmm. book. And you're right, like I was going to say this at the beginning, that I think you could have like a whole course, and there are courses on like generalized linear models.
Yeah.
And like all these link functions and, you know, how all these different kinds of models are related to each other. I really want to go back to that in particular and just really like, and do some of those kind of proofs that they were doing, you know, going from one, you know, equation to another form to show that it, you know, it's equivalent to whatever, like all those different transformations and steps they're doing in the book. I want to be able to do those by hand, and I think that like that'll be helpful, but I just didn't have, like you were saying, I spent a lot of time reading and got through it, but I think if you could really go over this many times, I think you would find something new each time.
I agree.
All right. I think we're probably good. I don't know how many are going to join today. I know Parnita is like job searching, so she's been busy. The woman who joined last week, I forget her name. I can look it up. She, I think, is going to have trouble joining. Apparently, it was 3 a.m. her time locally. Mm-hmm. So, Prahita, so it doesn't sound like she's going to be able to join in the future. So anyway, so I think it might just be us for today, which is fine. We'll have some good discussions. I'll go through this guide, and there's definitely a couple of things I want to like talk through and focus more on. I want to like, you know, give time for our own questions and discussions, especially since it's a small group, and really kind of talk through, excuse me, some of the things that we thought were interesting or confusing or needed some kind of working through. So I'll just, you know, do an overview, go into a couple of these, and then we can talk a little more about some of the things that we want to kind of shed light on. So just as a reminder, this was about classification in general, but there were you know, a few different kinds of classification algorithms or models that they reviewed. So logistic regression, linear discriminant analysis, quadratic discriminant analysis, naive Bayes, and as the next or the 4.2 shows here, there was a nice, I thought, like transition from what we've been talking about linear regression and why it's not a good choice for a classification scenario. Even if you're, you know, doing numeric coding, et cetera, like it still has a lot of problems in a classification setting. So we'll talk about that. And so the just to preview, the part that I really thought was really valuable was this, and I hope we can spend time talking about it, was that simulation stuff they had at the end where they kind of went through a bunch of different scenarios with different kinds of data and showed mm-hmm. the performance of each of these algorithms. And it was really nice because to see how violation of some of the assumptions of the models produces subpar performance. And I just thought that connection was really nice. It was nice to be reminded of what some of those kind of assumptions are in the construction of these models. Here we go. So this stuff here, I really liked it. So we can talk about that a little more. And I think there's a section here about it. So that was the part that I would love to focus a little bit more on, at least for my part. And then, and then we'll do questions. But yeah, so let's see what they have here. Okay, so they just give some examples of classification problems. In general, right? Like you have some kind of outcome that is like generally not ordered. It could be two classes, it could be more than two classes. They talk, I think at first in the chapter with logistic regression about kind of the two class case and then talk about more than two class case. I think it's the multinomial logistic regression case. So you could have something like presence or not of a disease. If something is like fraud, I think a really common example in this stuff when I've read a lot of, when I've read in the past about classification, people always talk about email like spam. So this is similar, I think, right? Like fraudulent activity, but like in the spam case, is an email, is it a spam email or not based on mm-hmm. whatever characteristics you want? And in that case, usually it's like the outcome is coded as 0 and 1. It doesn't even really matter what you choose as the kind of reference or the 0 and 1 value, you'll get the same kind of inference or same conclusion. Just like it would be it'll be the reverse kind of relationship depending on which one you make 0 1. So presence of some sort of a gene. And so they give some of these examples and show that like this student example was pretty interesting because about defaulting. I thought it was interesting because it shows like there's an overall effect of being a student where if you're a student and you don't consider like the balance of how much debt someone has, on average students are going to default more, but if you control for balance, students are less likely to default. So there's this kind of confounding happening, and they talk about that like in the interpretation of the model. So there's a little bit here about why not linear regression, just pretty briefly. So one issue is that you're not going to get your predictions bounded by like 0 and 1 in terms of like a probability. So you can get some estimates that are below 0 and some that are above 1, depending on like what your input is. It's a linear model. So it's just going to like continue to scale that outcome, up or down, depending on what the slope sign is. And you could go, way beyond this interval here. And you can definitely have some issues, with that. And it's just in general, it's not really set up to model kind of the probability of some kind of state happening. So let's see if there's any other points here that I missed. Yeah. So they're like, you might think, oh, well, I could give, if I have more than the two classes, I could do like 1, 2, and 3. But if there is no inherent ordering to them, then it's really not going to be a useful model. And then, yeah. So let's see what else. I think that's basically it. And when you use a logistic model that we'll talk about in a second, you get this nice curve that where all the predictions are between 0 and 1. And often it's kind of like this S-shaped curve, and it maps on a lot better to probability. So let's talk about that. So I really like here how they show kind of the two the contrast between linear and logistic regression. So in linear regression, right, we just have an intercept and a slope for every single predictor. And we could have interactions, et cetera. Could be, you could have polynomial terms, could be polynomial, linear regression. Polynomial regression where you have kind of some squiggly patterns, et cetera. But in general, right, you just have some kind of additive with logistic regression, you're actually fitting. So it looks kind of similar in terms of you have an intercept and slopes for each predictor, but it's going to be in the exponent in the numerator and the denominator of this logistic function. And depending on what slope and intercept the model finds reduces in this kind of maximum likelihood estimation technique, you'll get a curve that that looks like something like this. And could slightly change shape depending on the values of these exponents. So like the other kind of big difference with and besides the form is that the way that it's estimated is not ordinarily squares in terms of finding the right betas, it's maximum likelihood. What that means is that, for every single observation, you get a prediction, a probability of it being in the, in the two class example, it being in class one versus, the probability of it being in class one. And the maximum likelihood technique basically finds these beta coefficients that minimize the distance between that probability estimate and the actual observed label, so like 0 or 1. That's interesting. I didn't know. It says here, at least square method is actually a special case of maximum likelihood. I'd have to dig in more to that to understand what that means, but interesting that there's some link there.
One thing I just wanted to point an observation there about the log odds thing that found helpful was that I started thinking about this a little bit and I'm like, oh, this makes sense. Like, so if the odds of something are like 10,000 to one, let's say, and let's use base 10 for the simplicity, right? Then that we say log of that would be like, 4, right? Mm-hmm. And so four means it's a 10,000 to one against, and then minus 4 means 10,000 to one in favor, right? And that's a quick way to think about what the log odds mean. At least for me, I thought about that. Like, oh yeah, this makes more sense. I can kind of have some intuition about what log odds are, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, right. So it's the exponent, as it were, in the odds.
Right.
Does that make sense? I don't know. I found that helpful for me, my weird way of thinking about things. So I didn't have to constantly transfer back and forth. I just think directly about the log odds. Like, oh, it's a 10 to 1 shot. So that's a 1. And of course, that's base 10. I usually using, natural logs, but.
Right.
But same kind of principle, I think. Yeah, I just wanted to point that out. I thought it was useful. So it's not so mysterious, these log odds. Log odds, why would you use that? Well, this is why.
Could you say that again, just so I make sure I understand what you're saying?
I think I get part of it, if you could just say it again.
Well, the point I was trying to make is, like, why do you use log odds? Because log odds go from minus infinity to infinity, map minus infinity to infinity to ordinary probabilities, right? Mm-hmm. But you can also just think about them directly. What does the log odds of, like, 4 mean? Well, if you're doing base 10 logs, that would mean 10,000 to 1 thing happening, right?
Right.
Very likely to happen. You know, 1 in 10,000, well, 1 in 10,001, right? But of it not happening. And then minus 4 would be the other opposite. That's all just turn, 10,000 to 1 against it happening. Very unlikely.
So I get it. Yeah, I like that.
So it's the exponent, essentially, right? So yeah, the exponent makes sense. So a very large negative exponent is a very small number, a very large positive exponent is a very large number for the probability, for the odds. And it's easy to convert odds into probabilities.
Right, because it's the number that you would raise the base to in order to get the odds.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So anyway, I just threw that out there.
No,
and this likelihood thing threw me off too. I'm like, what are they talking about? So I did sit down and think about it a little bit. Now from the point of view, like a Bayesian point of view, it does make sense. Like that is the probability that you would have, that you would have seen that particular measurement. So it's a likelihood that you've seen that particular measurement given those probabilities. And the same thing is true for the least squared, but except in that case, the likelihood's a Gaussian, right? And so the exponent on that thing is vector sum of squares. So that makes sense to me. In broad strokes, I mean, it's something you really have to sit down and think about, I think, work out. But
yeah, I really want to see if there's any explanations of like the likelihood, maximum likelihood estimation process. I think I need it. Yeah, maybe in the other book, maybe it broken down a little more. But I get like I think something that like before I kind of knew anything about classification, I always assumed that like the output was the class,
right?
And it was like kind of weird to me at first that that you're outputting a probability that, and like you're not trying to, at that point at least, make a discrete estimate, and you're just saying like, I can hedge my bet in some cases, and say, oh, this observation is really kind of hard to classify. I'm going to just give it a 0.5. And whereas like, some other ones can be 0.95, 0.05, right, et cetera. But I think like in that context where, you're outputting kind of continuous probabilities, it makes sense that you want that probability to be as close as possible on average to all the observed classes.
Right. That's And that gives you flexibility to adjust as they go in the book. It gives you flexibility to adjust that threshold, right? You don't want 0.5.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. And then they talk about multiple logistic regression where, those exponents are, so it's the same form, but those exponents are just, like multiple terms. So let's see if we want to go into this a little bit more. Okay. So they do talk about, multinomial logistic regression. This took me some time to wrap my head around too, where you're choosing a reference class and then each term is like the log odds of being in that class over the reference class. Is that right?
That's how I read it. I've never done it before. So
I've never done that either. It just seems like if there is one class that like is different or like is conducive to being a baseline, then I think that could make sense. But if they're all kind of equivalent in terms of like, I don't know, like you're, you don't want like some sort of a contrast, then I don't see how, when I would use that. Yeah. I would have to think about it, but I just like, it didn't strike me as something like, I sometimes when I read this stuff, I'm like, oh, okay. Like this thing I work on, you know, I could use it for this case, but for this multinomial logistic regression, I have trouble finding a use case.
So do you guys often use this softmax coding, or have you used it?
Only in machine learning, only in like neural network stuff. I've never used it for direct multinomial thing before.
Yeah, same thing. Okay.
I guess the thing that I was, you know, the bike share example that they have almost at the very end. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when they're talking about like clear skies and then you have cloudy and then cloudy, rainy and then rainy snow. So the only maybe use that I would think for picking a baseline, if it's very interpretable in terms of the coefficient values, you know what I mean? Where one just builds up on the other. So your baseline being clear skies sort of makes sense intuitively.
Yeah.
As opposed to, I don't know, because I've never, you know, done this either of the two cases, but maybe this softmax coding, because all classes are treated equally, then you don't know if you're talking about something in reference to something else. And so I don't know if that just creates either more coefficients or it makes it more difficult to interpret. I'm assuming that it would have some kind of ordering regardless, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I mean, I'm just speculating because I've never done this type of regression.
Yeah, I like, for me, like I, as Ron mentioned, like I've literally, my extent of me using it is like passing it as an argument into a neural net thing in this boot camp I did, but I need to learn more about it to really understand what's happening
with it. Basically, it's like someone, they said use the softmax here, so that's what I'm doing.
Okay, yeah, it's like, well, I tried this other, you know, way of optimizing and like it just was terrible, and then I used softmax and it's great, so
yeah,
so celebrate. Yeah,
exactly.
Got
one second. All right, one second. I have to open something.
Right. Pickles.
Yeah. All right. All right. Okay. So they talk about generative models. All right. So if you have cases, I guess, where there's, let's see here, when there is substantial separation between two classes, logistic regression can struggle. If there you have a small sample size with kind of approximately normal distribution of predictors, generative modeling may be better. So when they're talking about generative modeling, they're talking about Bayesian methods here.
Okay.
And so they go right into Bayes' theorem down here. But I thought one thing that I thought was weird in this book that I thought would have been helpful, and I might add it to this page here later, is actually stating Bayes' theorem. Yes. They go right into like substituting terms, and I'm like, you're not, if you've never seen that theorem before, you don't have
it doesn't look like this.
Like it doesn't look like that. And like so let's just
But by the way, this Bayesian, this one, they call this a Bayesian method. I mean, the logistic regression is also a Bayesian method. I mean, it's Bayesian methods is done, can be done for logistic regression as well, and often is. I think the key thing with this generative method is in the word generative, right? In that the, and this took me a minute to get it, so I just want to take a second to share my thoughts on this, see if you agree, because I'm not 100% sure about this, but like in the logistic regression, the underlying model is that you've got this line, right? This linear regression. You put in your coefficient, your what do you call them? The values for your variables. What do you call those things? Not the predictors, but the, yeah, predictors. Okay, yeah. You put in your values for your predictors, right? And you get out a value. You plug that into that logic function. It gives you a probability that you're in that class or not, right? Mm-hmm. That's the way that model flows that direction. Whereas these generative models work kind of the other way. You start with the probabilities, some probability distributions, and you generate a bunch of cases for class A, and you get predictors. You're actually generating predictors with the with the Gaussian, for example, in the particular case they're going to use here, right? For each class. So you have two Gaussians maybe separated, or they will be separated, right, to be useful. But and then you actually generate predictors. That's the underlying model. You see what I'm saying?
Like this density function.
Yeah, the density function generates the values of predictors. That's kind of the other way around. Yeah. And then you're trying to figure out what values of the underlying model would have made something looks like what I actually have here, kind of thing. Right? That's the Bayesian part of it, I think, right? Because that's where you're flipping it around. But does that make sense? That's how I kind of understood the generative part of it. They didn't really fully spell that out that way, though. So that's kind of tough for me.
Because like in this
that's
case.
That's the part that I spent a lot of time thinking about. Like, what are they talking about here?
Yeah. So in this case, no, I think I follow what you're saying. So in this case, like if you're just mapping directly onto Bayes' theorem, you have A is your Y, right? B is like your X, right? And like your predictors. And in this, what you were talking about here is this part, right? That you're saying given a class, what is the probability distribution of your predictors here, right? Like what is the distribution of likely states of your predictors given your outcome? And then if you know that, if you know the distribution of your outcome, right, in the training set, and you know the distribution of your predictors, and you know the distribution. No, sorry, this is the outcome here, right? A is your outcome in this case, and then this is your predictors, right? So these here in the book, those map onto density functions, right? Is that right? Or
the PBA is a density function. P of A is the little pi. P of A is the pi. Like,
oh yeah, sorry. Yeah. You're right. Yeah. So this is the kind of like the rate of a particular class happening, right, in a training set.
That's
this is your density function, right? So conditional kind of probabilities. And this is the rate of or the probability distribution of your predictors, unconditional, the marginal distribution, right?
So do you think I'm right though, that's why they call that a generative model then? Because it kind of generates,
because like from here you're generating your predictors based on your outcome.
That's in my guess as I based on.
I also think that I think that may be totally right. Where my mind goes with generative with Bayesian modeling is that your output is a posterior distribution. So you're generating a distribution, like your output is a distribution of values.
Right. Okay.
You know, so I don't know. I'm not sure exactly if what part of it the generative refers to, but to me that's like kind of generative too. Like you're like based on the information, so you have like a prior, you have new information, and you're combining that, and then you're getting a new posterior distribution. So you're kind of like generating a new kind of expectation about the world based on that information. So I don't know, that's where my mind goes, but
that's helpful though for me. What you just said, so
cool. Yeah. But I think I think what you said makes 100% sense too. And I really liked in that part of the book where they're like, I can in my mind walk through Bayes' theorem when they're saying like, when they're doing that kind of flip, right? They're saying like we're going to actually start by saying what are the likely predictor values given this class, and then using Bayes' theorem, we can kind of fill in the rest and actually get a prediction of what we want, which is the probability of this class given the predictor.
Right.
Cool. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so here they're saying this is like the prior probability of a given class, right? So this would be in here, this would be P of A, right? The pi term here. And then this is that kind of conditional probability of X given K, a certain class. And then this is down here is the, so this would be, I guess the probability, it's the probability of X given any K, right? Right. So like this here is like, it's summing up all these probabilities for each K. So it's like doing this, except saying, let's do that for every single K so that it's not no longer a conditional probability. It's the entire scope of the, like, you know, not just not doing one class, right? What does the distribution X look like given every class or every possible class, right? I think, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Another way to think of it, just think of it as a normalizing constant, right? Just dividing by the sum of all the possibilities.
Yeah, exactly.
Kevin, sorry. So the prior is which one in the Bayes theorem? Is it the?
So I think it's this pi term, which would be the like the rate of that class that you're talking about, y equals k, that class you're talking about, given no conditions, just like overall.
Got it. But it was the p. X I think given it's, y?
It's this this pi k here.
Right. But can you go back to where you were showing Bayes
theorem? Oh, the actual theorem. Yeah. So that's P of A here.
Okay.
So it's like the probability of like the thing that we're trying to get the conditional probability for, the probability of that class occurring in general, and then across the whole data set. And then this, what we want is the probability of that class given the values that you see in the data set that we actually observe for your predictors.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. See, but like, I feel like unless you like sit there and like try to map on back and forth between Bayes' theorem and I just thought like they made some assumptions about people's understanding.
A good edit to the notes there if you did that.
Yeah, I'm gonna add it. I'll add it. Because I didn't make any other edits, so I'll add it.
You could probably fix that bug in the previous slide too with the
this here.
Yeah.
It's ugly.
It's just some bug obviously in the late thing, right? Or however you pronounce it.
I don't know. I heard someone pronounce it. I don't even know which way I think it's pronounced, but someone pronounced it the way that I didn't think it was pronounced last week. And it was someone who I respect very much. And I was like, well, I guess I'm wrong. But then I don't remember what they said. So
I run into that problem all the time where I start saying words like, wait a minute, I've only read this word.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. All right. Well, thanks for talking through that. That was really good. I thought it was a generative model bit. Okay, so they go over linear discriminant analysis. So basically, like, each of these methods has its own density function, right? That's like one of the main kind of differences here. Here this is the normal density function. So basically, like, one of the things that they're saying is that what's really hard is estimating this right here, the density function of X given K. So they're kind of focusing on that part here. This is a density function, assuming that you have a normal distribution. And so all they're doing here is they're plugging in this f of x given k to that formula that was kind of arrived at from Bayes' theorem down here, right? So that gives you this, just like substituting in that density function. So that'd be the kind of the density of x given given k, the distribution of expected kind of values of x given k. Okay, this is kind of some stuff where I need to sit down a bit more, but basically, let's see. So after you log and rearrange the above equation, you arrive at the following formula. Bayes classifier assigns one class. So if they're just saying you have two classes here, right? Class one and two. If 2x times the mean of class one minus the mean of class two is greater than the mean squared of class one minus the mean squared of class two. Do we understand where that comes from? let's see. If you log and rearrange the above equation, you will get the following formula. So, okay, so they're logging this, and then rearranging stuff, and they're getting this. I don't know how to say this Greek letter.
Delta.
Is that delta? Okay.
Yeah, delta. Little delta.
Delta k. So delta function, I guess, of x equals x times u for the mean of k minus over the variance squared minus the mean squared of k over 2 times the variance squared plus the log of pi k, which is the prior for your predictors. Huh, okay. So I get like this, if you just talk about for a second, this formula here and how if they're equivalent, right, that's where the decision boundary is, right? So above it, you predict one class, before below you predict another with this Bayesian like LDA method. But I guess I'd have to really do what they did and log everything and figure out exactly what this term is here. What I don't get is like, why is this still the probability of x given k here, except they rearranged stuff and did some transformations and they changed the to a delta. I don't like,
no, delta is not the probability. It's just some new function that they're saying is the bigger, whichever one is bigger is the one that's got the more probability, but it's not a probability anymore. It's not, I'm with you. I feel like I'd like to see how delta relates to P exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not sure. I can't see from like just looking at it what they did there either. I think there's some bunch of constants and stuff. Right.
Yeah.
Sorry, this is a dumb question, but so they log everything and they rearrange, and then now they're defining this delta function, right? Which looks like a difference function. I mean, intuitively, I don't understand. So you're looking at difference of means versus the difference of the squared means. And like Kevin was saying, right? So, and if one is bigger than the other, then you assign to one or the other class. But intuitively, the squared means does not make sense to me, so.
Looks like this is exercise two that we have to do this. So I guess.
Okay, great. That was the other thing. These exercises next week are going to be fantastic. So, because we're going to learn a lot. All right.
But reading from the text, it looks like delta is not, you know, it's not the probability. It's just they're saying it's equivalent to saying whichever one has the biggest delta, whatever delta is, is equivalent to saying whichever one has a bigger probability. But it's not delta is not equal to probability. It's like
because you log probability, a bunch of constants you've logged in there. Stuff.
Yeah, I think they threw away things like sigmas and stuff like that too, and they did it, I guess. But we'll see when we go through it. But
okay,
I hope. I
see. Let's see that. Let's
I'm with you. I'm like it's clear, basically clear as mud right now. But so,
yeah. I mean, honestly, like just a side note for a second, like I took a decent amount of math in college, and I have not touched a lot of it in since then, in like a direct kind of algebraic form, and it's a big win for me to just to like I over this time I've like built up some like anxiety about working through this stuff, and it's a huge win just to like talk through each of these terms and try to understand like at least like pronounce everything and like, you know, make sure that that we can like read through it and kind of at least start to have a conversation about it. It's really helpful for me. So I just like I think those exercises hopefully will help also me just like get back into doing some of this stuff by hand. But yeah, I've forgotten a lot. So
yeah, I did not take that much math. I think the highest that I did was calculus and then, you know, like super basic statistics.
Yeah.
So it is helpful. I feel lost most of the time, but at least I'm trying to get some sort of like a intuitive feel for what like,
right,
at least the difference in methods mean, right? Whether it's like a linear combination or.
Right. Or whatnot. Right.
Okay.
And yeah, I think, but like,
it's definitely helpful hearing you guys talk about it.
Yeah. Well, I'm it's a process for me, but but yeah, like I just think I also think that like each time you see this stuff and you see this content, you get a different layer of it, you know, and so I think we'll go a little deeper too if we do those questions next week, but like I said, like I think like I got into a habit for a while of like skipping math like written math and like in papers and stuff like that, and now I'm trying to get back to like really reading through it all, so yeah, it's a process, but
but I do think that's all they're saying. If you did that process, and by the way, just looking at it now, it looks like what you do is you just basically ignore the denominator because the same for it doesn't depend on k, right? So you can just like forget about that. Then we take the log of the numerator, you're going to get that, you know, plus log pi thing, and you're going to get plus that 1 over sigma squared or minus 1 over sigma squared times x minus mu k squared. When you square that out, there's like an x squared you don't care about anymore because that doesn't depend on k.
Right.
2 sigma pi, you know, so that's what I think they say when they say equivalent to. They're just like taking the kernel of that thing, the most important piece that depends on k.
Right, because if you log this whole thing, then you get the product of all these things inside the log, then you can say, which there's is the same sums, as the sum. Right. Yeah.
And then some of those things, a lot of those terms don't depend on K, so you can just forget about them.
Yep.
And then from that, you say, okay, well, then what about the decision boundary? That's when delta K is delta 1 needs to go to delta 2, and then you get that formula they derived there, right? The mu. That's when x is equal to mu 1 squared minus mu 2 squared, blah blah blah, which is just, you know, you remember mu 1 squared minus mu 2 squared is mu minus mu 1 minus mu 2 times mu 1 plus mu 2, right? So that cancels with the denominator to get that simple result there. It's just the average of the two means. You remember that, right? It's like x squared minus y squared is equal to, what are you calling me? Hang on a second. Yeah. Do you remember that little algebra thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to mute here for a second. I'll try to.
All right. Hello.
Yeah, hang on 1 second. Oops. I couldn't mute you guys. Hang on a second. Sorry.
Sure. All right. Well, I'll just keep going and then rejoin us. Okay. So they also talk about this. So this is, I thought, like, was interesting. So it's like they're saying that actually estimating these conditional density functions is really hard. Mm-hmm. And that they make some simplifying assumptions.
Right.
And I think one of those simplifying assumptions is that instead of having these, like, oh, maybe this is later in the book with where they're talking about like these covariance matrices, but hold on. So they're talking about.
Hey, sorry to interrupt, but that call, I got to go take care of this.
So oh, sure. Go
ahead. I'm going to leave early. I'll catch the rest of it on the video. Most important part here, the comparison stuff. But I actually didn't read this section of the book yet anyway, so it's just well. So I'll read it and then watch the video.
Sounds good. Well, we only have 10 minutes, so I don't know how much we'll get through, but yeah. See you next week.
All right, see you. Thanks, Ron. Appreciate it.
Bye, Ron.
Yeah, bye. Okay. All right. So we have, they're talking about mu k and mu hat, I guess, mu hat k.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a delta, right? Delta hat k squared is the weighted average of the same.
I think that's sigma. So
that sigma, variance. Sigma.
Yeah.
Sigma. Sorry. Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's hard to say.
Sigma squared is the weighted average of the sample variances from each of the k classes. So the LDA classifier assigns observation x equals x to the class for which. Okay, so they're just actually going to this derived delta function here, right? And they're plugging in these means, these variances, and this pi k, this prior. And then they're just like walking you through some examples where you have x and there, you know, some observations for x, and then they're saying this is what your predictions would be given, so this is how you would get like those kind of constants, I guess, right? And then mm-hmm. and then you would just plug in x and whichever for each k in whichever class has the highest result from this function here, right? Mm-hmm. For different x's or for a given x observation, then that would be your prediction. Is that right? Yeah, for which this is delta, right? Delta
yeah
k of x is largest. Whew. Okay.
Goodness. Can I ask you a question? So sure, if you look ahead, there where it says the sigma, like fit, sigma hat squared, a little bit higher. One more
up here, yeah.
Right, yeah, there, yeah. It's one over, so that's number of observations minus k classes, right? Why are there two sigmas there? So that's from k, little k class one through, you know, whatever is the maximum number of classes. And then there's a I colon y prime, y1 equals k. Like, why, what is that?
Good question.
okay. I was just like, maybe I'm just not getting this stuff at all.
The weighted, so it's the weighted average of the sample variances for each of the K classes.
Okay, weighted average of the sample
So I think it's adding up. So I think is this here, right here, just to uh-huh. the right here. This is the variance for a given class, right?
Yes.
So I think it's saying y1 equals k. So like the outcome is this k value, is this class of k. And so one individual class, right? So it's saying k to, so I think what they're saying here is that i is like the index of this outer sum maybe, or something like that.
Okay.
And then for a certain K class, you're getting the variance and then adding up all those variances and then dividing by the number of N. So I'm not sure what N is. It's number of observations.
Usually.
Minus K classes. So uh-huh. so that's like a weighted average, but it's weighing by, it's weighing by the number of observations somehow. In each class, maybe.
Right.
But I don't know how that there's just one. It doesn't look like N is a part of this thing until you get to the sum across all classes. So
that almost reminds me of when we were probably remember for just the linear regression. So hold on. Was it the SSE? 1 second. Because then at least that would sort of make sense in my mind. Sorry. Remember when we estimated the residual sum of or residual standard error, and that was just the square root of the residual sum of squares, and you then always sort of normalize by n minus sometimes number of predictors?
Maybe, yeah. Are you looking in your book or you have it on your screen?
I'm looking on notes that I took from last time, so.
Okay, but like, I was just wondering if you could share it. But it's in chapter 3?
It's in chapter 3, right? So let's see. When we're assessing accuracy of coefficients, right? So you always adjust by number of observations minus number of predictors. And in this class, in this case, it would be classes, I'm guessing. It's probably not important. Sorry, I don't want to.
Yeah, but there is some similarity there in terms of the form, like it looks very similar. Yeah, yeah.
But in this case, you're calculating the variance, right? Which is for linear discriminant, was it assumed to be equal variance for all classes?
I think so. Well, it's giving you maybe not equal variance, but you're using the weighted average of the variances across classes.
Okay, got it.
So like you're using one variance, but it's not.
Yeah.
It's not the same. It's just the weighted average of all of them, I think.
Yeah. Right.
So you could have different variances in each of these classes, but the thing you're using in your estimation is actually this weighted average.
Got it. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
LEA classifier, this is the largest.
Yeah, that makes sense actually. Okay.
Yeah. I wonder what this looks like in the book. Maybe we missed something in the in like the
what number population. Is it?
Oh 418 it seems. Let's see.
Okay, so I think it's page 144. Looks like 420.
Oh, 420. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's go to 144.
Yeah, I think it looks the same. So
420, this one.
Yes. Yeah.
But at least it's a little bigger. So good.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I'm gonna have to think a little more about how it's a weighted average, but it's all right.
Okay, yeah. Let's not worry about that.
We can keep moving for the last few minutes. unless there's something else there you want to talk about.
No.
Cool. Okay. All right. So then they're saying you can generalize this for more than one predictor. And then they use a class-specific mean vector and a common covariance matrix. You assume that each individual predictor follows a one-dimensional normal distribution with predictors having some correlation. Multivariate Gaussian density function is defined as this. And they derive the same kind of delta function here.
Right. Okay, that's good.
So it's basically, it's a very similar, formula here, except now this means and variances are, this is a class specific mean vector. So that would be, it's a vector of means for each predictor given a class, and then they use common covariance matrix. So the covariance of the predictors, right?
Covariant, yes. Kevin, can I ask a question? What is difference? Okay, so what is a covariance matrix? So I'm just relating this to the case of like linear regression, right? Where we were looking at, like, instead of a class specific mean vector, we're looking at the means and the variance, like the standard deviation, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm guessing that the class specific mean vector stands in for the mean in the case where you have, you know, many more dimensions of predictors, I guess. And then the covariance matrix is analogous, right, to the standard deviation quantity that we're looking at before in the case of just one predictor. Is that right?
I think so.
Okay, but what does covariance mean? So I was looking it up, and either some definitions were way too like mathematically involved, where I'm just like, okay, but that doesn't tell me anything. So what is covariance, for example, versus correlation?
Yeah, so I think there, if I'm remembering correctly, I think there's a direct relationship between the two. I think a correlation is basically like a scaled covariance, I think. Let me,
I think from just the language, and this may be incorrect, covariance to me suggests, right, how two things vary similarly with each other. Is that even right?
I think there is a direct, so this is what I mean. Like, so you have the covariance, and then you scale it by the variance of each of those variables, and then you get correlation, the correlation out of it. So that's all I've always thought. It's just like an unscaled correlation. But beyond that, I would have to look at the a little bit more at how covariance is calculated to really, let's see. So covariance is, so like for each observation, you say, how far is it from the mean of that vector or that variable? And then you multiply those differences. And so like, so I guess if we think about individual observations, like if you have, for each time, X is higher than its mean, and then Y is also higher than its mean, then both of those will be positive. And and then you, if you have a bunch of those added up and then averaged, you'll get a positive correlation, right? Or if they're both negative, right, they kind of go below the mean together, you'll get a negative covariance. So it's kind of like, I don't know, like how they move with respect to the mean together, right?
That makes sense, yeah.
Like, okay. And then kind of you average them, but then this can go however high, it can kind of take on any value, because it's just, you're just doing this multiplication of the observed value relative to the mean, but then correlations, you could take the covariance and then just scale it by the variances of each, and then you get something that's standardized across all types of doesn't matter about the range or the scale of like the predictors that you're looking at.
Okay, that's probably gonna take me some sorting out, but thank you for explaining the covariance. I think that at least getting that helps a lot.
It's really helpful to talk through it too, because like I don't have this formula memorized, and I forget like sometimes what generally what this looks like. So it's helpful to talk to talk through it, but
okay.
Yeah, it's really helpful. So then you would have a covariance matrix, which is just every kind of pairwise covariance of between each of the predictors.
Yeah, okay.
So,
that makes sense. All right.
So yeah, I think that's right. All right, so they're talking about Bayesian classification. So maybe I don't want to move. It's hard because like I don't want to move these sessions when we've had these really good discussions and we need to get through more of the content. Mm-hmm. Like I don't want this book. So the problem I'm having is this book is so long, and mm-hmm. there's so much to talk about that.
Yeah.
That like if we keep on, you know, adding another week for each chapter in addition to the lab, that like we're gonna be here next June, you know, like.
Yeah, I guess I just came from R4DS and that was over a year. So right, I'm like right, 13 right. or 26 weeks is nothing. But it sort of depends, you know, how, at what pace like the rest of the group wants to move. Cause I'm always very, I can get hung up on details sometimes, you know, that then I wanna investigate every last thing. But I can also, you know, be more flexible in terms of like what everyone else wants.
Yeah. Okay. Let me just look through quickly. So we have linear regression with count data, and they talk about Poisson. Poisson, is that you say?
I think Poisson. It's Poisson.
Poisson. Yeah. Poisson. French, right? Yeah. Poisson distribution that works really well with it's explicitly like modeling counts and has to be greater than zero, etc. I'm not really sure, like it is kind of like a you know, a different kind of distribution. I'm not sure mm-hmm. if we need to really go into this that deeply unless anyone wants to is really, really into this particular type of distribution or really going over it. I think what I would love to do with everyone is go through these generalized linear models and these examples with the different, I don't even know where this, I thought it was in the summary, where they do the different kind of simulated data sets.
Is it not there in the book though?
I thought it was. I thought I saw it.
That would be one of the best parts of the chapter, like you said.
Yeah. Well, we can always add it because
that's true.
Trying to make it better, but like I thought I could have sworn I saw it.
Okay.
Am I like on a different version somehow? It's really weird. Summary of the, oh, here we go. They're up here. Got it.
Oh, okay.
So I don't know. It's because okay. I think in the book it comes after Poisson, but maybe it doesn't. I thought at least it came after generalized linear models. But maybe not though. Because this is, yeah, okay. But yeah, I think like talking through these might be good. So this is what I propose for next week is basically talking through this section, because these are kind of like questions in a way, like they're kind of like exercises, right? Like you're talking through each scenario and saying like why, like we could talk about why each of these is true. Mm-hmm. And then go to the kind of questions in lab and what Sham has wants to do. I think like we get kind of some of this really good stuff that we didn't cover today, but also try to stay on schedule.
Okay.
Does that sound okay?
Yeah, that sounds fine.
Okay. So maybe like the first 10 minutes more on this. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wait, I had made some notes as to my question. Okay, one second. RC curves. Okay, so I think my question was, now I lost the heart. 1 second, sorry. Features predictors. Okay, so actually this is relating to figure 4.12, right? Of the examples that you were talking about. Probably we'll cover this next week, but I just had a question. So
sure, let me go to...
It's a page 163.
Let's go to that. Here, 412.
163, yes, scenario six, right? So it says these are generated from a normal distribution with different diagonal covariance matrix for each class. Okay, that makes sense. With a very small sample size, right? And it says, so the naive Bayes performed very well because its assumptions are met, and then LDA and logistic regression perform poorly because the true decision boundary is not linear. I get that. Due to the unequal covariance matrices. So why do unequal covariance matrices make the decision boundary not linear?
Yeah.
Does this have to do with, there's a figure, let me see if I can find it. So what page is this? Page 154, figure 4.9.
Here.
Yeah, okay. But here they're talking about different correlations, which I would assume, now that we've sort of gone over the equations, means that the covariances are also different, right? And so on the left, you have something that is a linear decision boundary, right? And you have a positive correlation of 0.7 between X1 and X2 for both of the classes. And you can tell that, right? Mm-hmm. But on the right-hand side, this is a non-linear decision boundary, right? And here the correlation is -7 for the blue class between X1 and X2, and +7, like in the other panel, for the orange class between X1 and X2, right? So I guess somehow that it makes sense that if the variances are different, it would mean that the decision boundaries are non-linear.
Are non-linear. Yeah.
That's a really good nugget. I'm almost imagining, right, that the blue, since it's spread however it is almost like pushing the orange away from a linear area. I don't know how to describe it, but that's where I also was getting confused, right? What's the difference between the covariance, the correlation, and then how does that affect the decision boundary? So maybe just something for me to think about till next week.
Honestly, I think you should post it in the channel so that other cohorts could see it too, and just see if anyone has any ideas about it.
I will do that. So I'll just ask
that. Yeah, I don't, it's a really good nugget to pick up on. I don't have a good answer, but it feels like the answer is gonna teach us a lot about how this all works.
Right. So, because then it makes sense in terms of why you're selecting a specific model, whether it assumes a linear decision boundary, and then a lot of the assumptions have to do with whether the covariance is equal or not, or if predictors are independent, in the naive Bayes.
I need to look at it for a while, and just process the covariances and the boundary and try to understand, how this.
Yeah, this chapter was just chock full of stuff, and a lot
there's
of stuff
so much.
Was very mathematical, and then that I had trouble even conceptualizing, so. Right. And I don't know if it's just the fact that also they don't explain it, right? Like, because they seem to switch between covariance and then they're showing correlation in this plot. But then they talk about, again, the covariance influencing like the decision boundary. And I'm like, it didn't show that anywhere, or at least I didn't get it from the math, you know? So.
Yeah, I guess like you can imagine like, yeah, like if you, I don't know, I'm just talking out loud, but if you like, in this case, you could just, like if you had a line going from the best fit through this whole plot, right?
Yeah.
Like,
like a progression line.
At one point on that line, you would just be like, kind of below this point, it's one class generally, and above this point, it's another. Here, I don't know. Maybe I'm not going the right track there, but just like trying to, it's so interesting. So you have a negative covariance or a negative correlation and positive correlation here. I mean, it almost seems like maybe even, I don't know. Yeah, I guess it is negative here. They're definitely different.
Right.
I mean, the hard thing here though, too, for me is that this nonlinearity is kind of subtle. Like it's not obvious to me that if I saw this decision boundary here, I would say it's really that suboptimal, you know?
Right.
Like it seems like you were missing just as many, you know, maybe a few less, you know, like, or I don't know. Like, it almost seems like if you drew this line here, there are more, I don't know. It seems like you might have a similar error rate.
Right. Let me see.
I'm not convinced by this nonlinear decision boundary, I guess. right. Like this linear one just doesn't seem that bad.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's see. I'm gonna just shot in the dark here. Covariance and nonlinear decision. I think maybe they're like making an implicit connection to QDA or something. And then maybe it's easier to figure out the answer to this question by looking at the formula for QDA, for the math for QDA, and because it says here it allows for more flexibility in the covariance matrix. So maybe it's just like via QDA. I don't know though. I'm just thinking maybe QDA, looking at QDA in more detail might tell us more about why if you have that flexibility, you can model a nonlinear boundary.
Right.
You know, like it might just be in the math, like that might be the answer, you know, of like how, no, I mean, already a minute.
Okay.
How I was saying before, what I was trying to say is I've been like scared of looking at equations in detail for a long time, and just like, you know, talking through what we can here is so it's like math therapy, you know, like getting over just the initial sight of it and just familiarizing with these terms and kind of what they're representing. So anyway, maybe that could be a part of the answer here. Just look really quickly. I have to run, but okay, that's the only place it appears. They talked about it in chapter 4, right? Quadratic
discriminant,
QDA. QDA isn't in here. Oh, there we go. QDA provides also. However, unlike QDA assumes each class has its own covariance matrix. That is, it assumes the observation kth class kx is a sigma k's covariance matrix for kth class. So unlike in 4.2.4, the quantity x appears as quadratic function in 4.2.8. So I feel like it's a reference to this, like this quadratic function is able to model something that's nonlinear. And it's because you're using a different, like, because you're using a different covariance, somehow you have multiple like x terms and that becomes a quadratic function. I don't know. You know what I mean? Like you have x, so since this is transposed, x transpose equals x times quadratic. So this is a covariance matrix here. So it's like inverse the covariance matrix. Or yeah, I think it might be the answer, but anyway.
What was the answer? So
like that when you're using QDA and you're using a form like this that allows for a different covariance matrix for each class, mm-hmm. then your when you come up with the functional like form like this, you end up having like squared x terms that allow you to fit a nonlinear function, like a quadratic function. Does that make sense? Like something in that realm, I think.
Yeah,
but okay, but I don't know.
That's sort of making sense.
But I don't know the reverse. Like, why does it? Is it true that every time there's a nonlinear boundary, there have to be like unequal covariances across the classes? I don't know. Yeah, but I
see what you're saying. Yeah, that's why I was sort of wondering. Like, did I just misinterpret the sentence? But it seems like that's what they're saying, right?
Yeah.
Well, the decision boundary is nonlinear. Yeah. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Thank you for your help, Kevin.
But I'll just post awesome.
It on the.
Yeah. No, so no problem. I would put that quote in there in your question from the book, and then put it in there. Put in your question, and then ask if anyone else has any insights. Because like, that's a really good, such a good question, and I just like just thinking about it right now with you is a really valuable. So thank you for bringing that up.
That's no problem. Thank you for always being so like involved in this and staying over time, and you know we really appreciate it.
Yeah of course. And I'm just learning like you guys, so yeah, all right, well I gotta run, but thanks again for the meeting. It was really good, and see you next week.
All right, see you next week. Bye.